Good morning, friends. As this is an 11 a.m. service, and as it is a choir Sunday, we're going to have a packed house. We already have a packed house. I encourage you to get close, literally, with your neighbors. I think, can people sit up there, David, or is there a reason people can't sit in the front row? Okay, Jack, Karen, people can sit in the front row if more come in. Great, excellent. Love to see it. Friends, we have quite a few announcements before we get into our service today on nostalgia. Hot topic, nostalgia. First of all, the scammers are at it again. The scammers are at it again. They want to take advantage of generous communities like our church, and they are going to come at you from these weird email addresses and phone numbers that say that they're the president of the board or me or something like that, but they're not. And they're going to be like, send me everybody's phone number or buy me a $500 gift card or things like that. I will never ask you to do that. Never. If you get a text or an email from a number that you don't know or from an email that says it's from me and it asks you to do any of those, do not do it. It is a scam. It is a scam. All right? Okay. If you are, well, okay, so there was going to be a young adults group meeting today, but the person organizing it was feeling under the weather. So if you are between the age of like 18 and 29 and you're interested in helping to form a new young adults group, stay tuned. Stay tuned. It is coming. you can see the welcome table or torch in the meantime to sign up for a circle supper. So circle suppers are awesome events. They're dinners, usually hosted at people's houses, where you get to meet members of the congregation that you normally wouldn't meet because they're a little outside of your, you know, whatever, demographic, I guess, which is one of the coolest things, I think, about church communities is you get to meet people from different generations, people from different walks of life, from different interest groups and stuff like that. If you are interested to either host one of these or to attend one, please see the welcome table out there in Elliott Hall after service, or there are links in the torch. If you do not sign up for the if you don't get the torch, sign up over there or online. 30s, 40s, and thriving is thriving. There is a QR code for this group, for the group's WhatsApp, at the welcome table. If you are in your 30s or 40s and you are thriving or you want to be thriving, check that group out. It's full of like-minded people. All right, camping trip. There will be a camping trip August 16th through 18th. I am talking about it this early because one needs to register. Registration is open now and space is limited at the Pine Valley North Wasatch. That's how you pronounce it, right? Yes. I did not do that right in the first service. I only moved here like 10 months ago, and whenever I say that word, my Midwestern like leaps to the surface and is like, Wasatch! And it's marked me. So anyway, if you want to join at the Pine Valley North Wasatch Cache Group Campground, sign up in the... What did I do? What did I do? Is that wrong? What is it? Did I do it wrong? Cache. I can't win, people. Never leave your hometown. That is the underlying message. No. If you want to come to this, whatever it was, you know what it is. I don't need to say it again. Sign up in the torch or at the welcome table. If you need dirt, it is gardening season. We have a bunch of dirt over there that we need to get rid of. You need it for your gardens. Bring a sack, bring a shovel. You know, it'll feel like you're doing something illegal, but I'm giving you permission now. It is fine. Go get that dirt before the 30th. Many people have already gotten dirt. It is great, right? Jessica, you got some dirt, right? And it was great, right? Great dirt. Here, free, out there. The Zabriskie Requiem is happening this year for the first time since COVID. If you have not experienced this before, it's a beautiful evening of original music. It's a full requiem sung by the choir, and it is a night to remember those we have lost. And since we have not done one since before COVID, we are going to be remembering everybody from our community that we have lost since 2020. It's going to be a beautiful evening. It will be two evenings, actually, May 11th and May 12th at 7 p.m. May 11th, it will be here at First Unitarian, and May 12th will be at Zion Evangelical Lutheran Church. So mark your calendars for that. And in the spirit of Requiem, in case you missed our email, beloved longtime member Pam Mullen passed away on April 16th. We send our condolences to the Mullen family. Finally, today at 1 p.m., join the Environmental Ministry for an in-person interview with Victor Puertas. It will be at 1 p.m. in Elliott Hall. Victor is indigenous from Peru, and he is also a resident of Provo, Utah. But he was arrested in Atlanta at a music festival because he was supporting marginalized communities whose forest is being destroyed by a construction project in Atlanta. So, long story, but we've been supporting him. He is one of our, you know, Utah friends and a very important activist, and he will be out there answering questions. He's facing some pretty serious charges, including domestic terrorism and RICO. So come hear his story today and learn how we can help support him in Elliott Hall at 1 p.m. All right. Now, on to nostalgia. Today for our chalice lighting, instead of a poem or a quote or something like that, I'm just going to ask us to have a brief quiet moment, as quiet as will be in this beautiful, wonderful intergenerational service where many, many people of different ages are. I invite us all to sit for a few moments in silence and reflect upon a memory or a scene that for you feels like home. Okay? Close your eyes if that's helpful, and we'll just take about 40 seconds or so. Thank you. Friends, I am very pleased to welcome up today's lay minister, Kathryn Ann, who will be speaking about April's lay minister theme of renewal.
Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
What a beautiful theme today. Renewal is a beautiful theme, but remembrance of times past is also beautiful. Love the music. So, our need for renewal seems to occur endlessly. Whether we are up to it or not is a variable. I will share some renewal attempts at my own past life here the last 3 years. As some of you know, I made a decision to move from Eugene, Oregon to Salt Lake City, Utah, over 3 years ago. My cousin had been asking me for the past 5 years to live with her, and I finally decided to do that. But after a month of living with her, I realized I'd made a mistake. It wasn't going to be worked out by saying to myself, just give it time. No, I'd have to pack up again after just getting settled in. I quieted myself down and gave it a lot of thought and listened. I talked to my cousin and we finally made a decision to live in separate apartments at Friendship Manor and managed to keep our friendship. That created a renewal of hope in our ability to work through very difficult situations. Life goes on. That was during COVID, and I was isolated in my own apartment. Isolated in what I felt was a foreign land. I'd sold my car and I needed to get around to buy groceries and everything else one needs. I had to learn how The buses worked in Salt Lake City, and that really seemed like a big challenge. But it turned out to be an adventure. I got information from the bus service only to find out that I could have a trainer to help me through this process. My trainer was kind and funny, and I had the feeling of finding a friend. And we did stay in touch for a while, and I now knew how to manage my transportation around town and felt more at ease. To my joy, I realized that the Unitarian Church was just a block away. I could see it out my window. The church was shut down due to COVID, but I could watch services on Zoom. I felt myself moving toward another renewal through the sermons of Reverend Tom and Reverend Monica. Wonderful. But then another thing was happening. I began missing old friends in Eugene. This sadness became oppressive. I was trying with the thought of, I was toying with the thought of moving back to Eugene, but I couldn't imagine how I'd manage another move or how I would afford another move. It was spring by then, and that lifted my spirits. Renewal. Oh, how lovely. Friendship Manor had garden beds, and I was able to get one. Well, who would have guessed? There was not only the beauty of caring for my garden bed, but a beautiful woman was wandering around in that garden area. And she introduced herself to me. I've been single for 14 years and was not looking for anyone to come into my life. But there she was, and I was falling in love. Renewal, yes. She asked me to marry her. Another deep look within myself. How could I hold on to myself and be in a relationship with this incredible, exciting, good-humored character of a woman? Ups and downs, change, renewal of commitments, acceptance of each other as we are, all worth it for renewals in our relationship. No matter what happens, we can always start again. No matter what the situation, we can always pause and listen with kindness and courageously plant new seeds. I remember my yearly spring drives with my grandmother as a young girl. She was always thrilled with the renewal of the earth. From winter to spring. Year after year, she'd say, "Oh, Kathy, have you ever seen so many shades of green? Have you?" And I would earnestly look deeply to see what she was seeing. It was magical, and I do it to this day in honor of her and in honor of hope and renewal. The renewal that has happened from belonging to this beautiful church has been great. A sense of community, of belonging, and meaningful work, and a renewal of energies. And add to that, along comes Reverend Jay, inspiring all of us, lifting us up into various streams of renewal. Thank you, Reverend Jay. Self-renewal is a part of our spiritual journey. Only by learning how to renew ourselves will we be able to reconnect with our purpose in life, reignite our passion, and discover our true spirit. Thank you.
you, Jim. Thank you, everybody. It's so beautiful. My friends, I don't often bring you readings for the meditation, but today I did. So this is a reading by somebody who I actually knew back in a time that I can now be nostalgic for. It's a book that just came out a couple weeks ago, I think, maybe a month ago. It's called Let me make sure I get the title right. There's Always This Year on Basketball and Ascension by Hanif Abdurraqib. If you are interested in basketball or home or just being a human being, I highly recommend picking it up. There's Always This Year by poet and cultural critic Hanif Abdurraqib is a book about many things, including faith, love, basketball, aging, growing up black in the United States, growing up lower income in the United States, spirituality, celebrity worship, and being Midwestern. But I would say at its core, it's a book about home, or at least the feeling of home, or at least the memory of the feeling of home, which maybe is all any of us ever get in the first place. So this is an excerpt from There's Always This Year on Basketball and Ascension by Hanif Abdurraqib. It was best if shots slipped through the rim, but it could be argued that there was also magic in the shots that missed, at least for how that missing would invite the orchestra of laughter, high-pitched and uneven but still sweet. Some days I would have rather failed but been in awe of the rapturous joy I got to fold into with my crew. Boys who were not yet big enough or good enough to play on a real basketball court where the games mattered, and so we made our own game, one where we could be small and inconsequential gods, architects of the miraculous. I never wanted to be anywhere but where I was. My 2 feet planted on concrete that was breaking but still satisfied to be of use. When we were young, so many people I loved just wanted to live forever where we were. Some of us carved our names into trees, into the wet concrete of new sidewalks. Some of us took small knives to metal and wrote our names onto the death traps of the 90s playground. And so we stay, one way or another. When Brian Wilson completed the song God Only Knows, he spoke of the impulse to fade the song out on a loop of the chorus, suggesting that it creates a sort of infinity spiral, a world where the song is still going always somewhere. And you, the listener, are still in it as you were at the time of listening, a dream with no exit. There is a universe always where you are joyfully encased in the endless return of chorus, and you might age there, but let's say you don't. Let's say you and the chorus both lock into a type of eternity, a forever of wondering, God only knows what I'd do without you. God only knows what I'd do without you. God only knows what I'd do without you. An eternity of praising the fact that you'll never have to find out. And it is both beautiful and heartbreaking to imagine this, that we go on living while a past version of ourselves remains locked peacefully in a euphoric dream. What I have been asking is for a reimagining of eternity, a reversal perhaps, not that our happiest, freest selves are fastened to a dream while we exit and return to the living world, but that our exit is where the dreaming begins. And our real, actual living is the place where we remain at our most joyous. Time moving forward by small inches, each of us growing only seconds older with each passing year. It has maybe all been a dream. It could be true that I am still living in the kingdom of a ball descending from the sky while I stand on an unevenly painted foul line waiting with my arms open. The friends I believe I will always love, forever counting down, a series of falling numbers, but the clock never reaching its end. the words of Hanif Abdurraqib. Thank you, Reese, for special guest starring on the keys with David. That was beautiful, guys. Now I have to follow that. Oh, we give thanks for this precious day, for all gathered here, and those far away, for this time we share. For this precious day. My friends, the offering for the work of the church will now be gratefully received, and please take this time to greet one another as well. For this service about nostalgia came to me when I saw a video. It was an older video, probably from early mid 20th century, but it was a video of four Irish women huddled together over a rustic table in front of a lake, and they looked like Irish, if you know what I mean. Like their names were probably like Siobhan and Neve and Saoirse, and those are the only Irish names I know, so I don't know what the fourth one was called. But they were working wool, and they were leaning back and forth in rhythm, slapping the wet, soapy wool over and over on the table. And as they worked, they sang together in Gaelic. And the song, it was clearly a working song, because the rhythm helped them to stay in sync as they did this back and forth movement and slapped the wool. But something else struck me about the song. It appeared to be a song known by heart by each of these women and sung just as easily as one breathes. One passed down probably from generation to generation because the group of women was intergenerational. You know, the youngest maybe in her 20s, possibly even in her teens, the oldest probably in her 70s or so. And that is something that you do not see very often here today, at least outside of like a church, right? What I mean is truly intergenerational groups singing the same song. So watching this video, I had a vision of what songs used to mean for communities versus what they mean now. And this is not based on empirical evidence. It was pure intuition and no doubt some mawkishness as well. So, like, feel free to go do research and tell me all the reasons I'm wrong about this. But in my vision, I envision small communities of humans singing together songs that tied the people together, right? Their families, their clans, their villages, their place, their homes. And I do know that some anthropologists believe that we did sing before we spoke, that singing together helped us to build group solidarity well before we worked out those precise and finicky nuances of spoken language. And this does make intuitive sense to me as well, because songs can glue groups of people together in ways that few other things can. But songs rarely bind us across generations these days, do they? Now songs are commodified and consumerized, and new pop songs are marketed primarily to young people and tied to generational identities that implicitly shut out other people, older people. And older people tend to continue to listen to the music that they loved when they were themselves young. And if we listen to new music, it's always as sort of an outsider. Like, I will never listen to a Taylor Swift song in the same deep, visceral way that I listened to a Tori Amos song from 1997. It just is not going to happen. Here's a story. So 10-ish years ago, I was in a hipster falafel place in the Lower East Side of Manhattan. And it was like the post-bar hour, and there were about seven random strangers also eating falafel, I'm assuming to also soak up their Fernet and PBR. It was a different time. Everyone in that shop was around my age, and I know this because when Hand in My Pocket from Alanis Morissette's transcendent 90s album Jagged Little Pill came on, every single person in that shop began singing it at the top of their lungs, lyric for lyric. There was no discussion, but there was some loving and amazed eye contact as we all belted every single word together. It was a cluster of aging millennials saying goodbye to the last shred of their youth. And this was a lovely communal moment. But part of my point is that these days, and by these days I mean like the last 100 years or so, Songs tend to lock us in our generations rather than tying us together with our wider community. And though the intergenerational inter-identity bond can be beautiful, as we saw in that falafel shop, I believe that we miss something important about being human if we spend our lives socializing exclusively with those we could have gone to school with. And I think we intuitively know that we are missing out on that wider intergenerational bond, a sense of place, of home, that goes beyond our culturally creative, aggressively marketed generational markers, Gen Z, Millennial, Gen X, Boomer, whatever. And I think this is why Christmas songs tend to transcend generations. The holidays are the only time of year when we can hear songs from the 40s and the 60s and the 80s and the aughts and last year, all in order, right next to each other on the same station. We still play Jingle Bells, Rocking Around the Christmas Tree, Little Drummer Boy, Silent Night, Last Christmas, All I Want for Christmas Is You, as well as whatever Ariana Grande is doing. This is both because around the holidays, our culture is the most nostalgic, and also because the holidays are one of the few times our cultural nostalgia truly does seek to bridge generations. I mean, think about it. The cultural image of Christmas is a family, grandparents to babies gathered around a Christmas feast, a truly intergenerational scene of home. Now, I'm not sure, you might not know this. At the first inception, nostalgia was conceived of as a disease. In 1688, a Swiss medical student named Johannes Hofer described a condition that had been observed in many Swiss soldiers, especially those from small rural towns and mountain towns. Mountain towns, watch out. These young soldiers would miss their homes so badly that they would become physically ill. They would become bedridden, they would get fevers, and some even died. Though it was known that this was a common problem in the army at the time, Hofer was the first to name it in his dissertation, and the name he chose was nostalgia. So in Greek, algia means pain, and nostos means home. So home pain, homesickness, I guess you could call it. And like today, music was deeply tied to nostalgia. In fact, there were certain songs that could not be played in the Swiss army. Simple herding songs that mountain folk would use to call sheep in from the pastures. And in fact, we still have one in pop culture. It's often played in media over like pastoral scenes. It goes like do 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 do, right? So if you played that in the Swiss army in the 17th century, like half of it would just bust into tears and be completely useless. So it was banned. So the only cure for nostalgia was going home. Patients would be actually discharged, at least for a temporary leave, and they would visit their hometowns. And according to Hofer, this worked 100% of the time. Now, I would say that our current culture is a little obsessed with nostalgia. But what is the home that we are longing for? Is it literally the town we grew up in? Or is it something a little more amorphous than that? Because we certainly move around a lot, right? As adults, we often live far away from where we grew up, especially if we grow up in certain places. I remember when I was 14 or so in Indianapolis, a few of my friends were talking about where we wanted to live as adults. And I don't remember exactly where they said they wanted to move, but let's just say it was like all the usual upper middle class white kid places like New York or California or like France or whatever. But what I remember is that I was the only one who said I didn't see why I would want to leave because everyone I loved was here. And my friends made fun of me for that. But interestingly, according to Facebook, all three of those kids now live back around Indianapolis. And I, like, don't, so I don't know what's going on here. Anyway, Hanif Abdurraqib wrote about his own growing up in Columbus, Ohio, right next to Indiana. He said, "I come from a place where people leave." Though Hanif and I both grew up in the Midwest, it does bear mentioning that you know, and our friends were eyeing maps and dreaming of other zip codes. You know, it does bear mentioning that the statement means something different for him than it would have for me, right? Because I grew up fairly privileged in a fancy suburb, and Hanif grew up on the far east side of Columbus, where the cops dubbed it Uzi Alley. So making it out of somewhere can mean something different to white kids of well-off parents and to black kids of lower-income parents, absolutely, to be sure. But bearing all that in mind, there was this idea, just in general, in the Midwest, and I think across the board, that if you were going to make it, whatever that means, you needed to go far away. And Hanif did move away. For several years in his 30s, he lived in New Haven, Connecticut, with his then wife. But his heart was longing for home. In There's Always This Year, he writes, "It's easiest to measure the distance between where I am and where I want to be in miles, in minutes. It is unfair to measure such distance in heartbreak, in loneliness, in how long it takes to stop staring at a photo of old friends, the absence that you might occupy around a table. The drive, when mapped out on a weekday morning, should take about 9 hours and 40 minutes, regardless of which route is chosen, but desire is an accelerant. In 2016, I was in Connecticut because I had to be there. Someone I loved was there. I knew not to measure the distance between my new home and my old home by time because I knew the drive well. I made it often, made up excuses to make it. A friend was doing a poetry gig that I just had to see. Another friend's dog died, and they absolutely needed me home. I could make that 9.5 hour drive in just under 8 hours some days. But the drive back felt quick as the exhale of a breath. No matter how I tried to extend it, how many rest stops I walked through, how many trees off the side of the road I stopped to admire, I would start my car and be back. Away from the home I wanted but couldn't have, returned to the home I had but didn't want." So, you know that thing of when you used to do shows with somebody in a Cambridge nightclubs and then they win the MacArthur Genius Grant? Just me? Okay. So, like, I met Hanif when I was living in Cambridge, and I was deeply entangled with the poetry and weird performance art scene, and he would come in for readings. So he didn't just drive back to the Midwest, he also sometimes drove eastward as well. For the two-ish years that he lived in New England, he made an incredible impression as being a staggeringly talented writer and performer, as well as just generally lovely to be around, which is a remarkably rare combination. And, you know, we were acquaintances. I don't want to, like, overstate our relationship, but we knew each other, and we did shows together and readings and such. And this was way before he was a national best-selling author and MacArthur Genius Fellow. But I remember that we were both Midwesterners living in New England. He from Ohio, living in Connecticut. Me from Indiana, living in Massachusetts. I didn't know how much longing for home was eating him up while he was performing in those nightclubs in Boston. But reading about it now, I actually relate. I remember going to sleep in my crappy apartments in my mid-20s in this weird, cold, Calvinist culture of New England, wishing I could go back home, feeling like I couldn't if I wanted to be a real adult. Of course, I stayed there for over a decade, made deep friendships, and then New England became a kind of home for me. And now I can be nostalgic for New England, for the small old apartments and the nightclubs of Cambridge, as well as for the Indiana of my childhood. Now, these days nostalgia is not thought of as a disease, and in fact, there is some preliminary scientific evidence that it can even be good for us. Far from being lost in the past, one study suggests that those who experience some nostalgia feel more deeply and are more present and mindful than those who do not. And as we already know, music is one of the things that most strongly ties us to feelings of nostalgia and to memory in general. Another study has shown that for people suffering from dementia, musical memories can be easier to access than those not associated with song. Nostalgia itself is not bad by a long shot, but how can we use it to bring us together instead of further isolating us? Hanif did move home to Columbus after a few years of trying out New England. And if his Instagram posts are to be believed, he has been happy there ever since. And his career has thrived at home. He became a National Book Award finalist from a place that people leave. He won the MacArthur Genius Grant in a place that people leave. But more than that, it seems, he has reconnected with his friends and family there. Now, Hanif and I are about the same age, just beginning our 40s. It's like peak nostalgia era. And I have to say, part of me has been a little jealous that he was able to return home to the Midwest, at least in the abstract. Like, now as a middle-aged parent of a young child, I am finding myself longing ever more strongly for a real sense of home. I think one of the reasons that nostalgia has been so uniquely and aggressively marketed in our age is because we lack that sense of cohesive community. We move around, yes. We don't live near our families. We keep friends for only a few years before they or we pick up and move somewhere else. But even more than not living physically near our families, we are not tied to groups and communities in the same way that we used to be. We are isolated by technology, by media, by communities planned by cars, maybe even if we live down the street from our mothers. So we long for a sense of home. We dream of a memory of home, and we try to get back there. But can you ever really go back? Though he moved home, Hanif writes that Columbus is no longer the city of his childhood. In There's Always This Year, he laments the gentrifiers, the craft breweries and the barcades and the luxury condos that infringe upon the ecosystem of the Columbus of his youth. In so many ways, as they say, you can't go home again. I think partially what our current obsession with nostalgia points to is that we long for something that connects us across time. We long to break out of these culturally imposed niches that fractalize us into nuclear families, into political parties, into an ever-lengthening list of identities, into millennials, boomers, Gen Z, and Gen X. Nostalgia can be a good thing, but remember, it was originally a disease. The cure for this type of nostalgia in the 17th century was to go home. Now, for Hanif Abdurraqib, going home, in fact, was the cure, or at least part of a cure. But if literally going home is not possible or even desired, how do we grow beyond the isolating type of nostalgia into the kind that helps us to be more loving, sensitive, and present? Well, friends, we must always be doing the work of creating home. We must let nostalgia guide us to what we are looking for, rather than lock us in the belief that the feeling of home is something that is only in the past. This is true if you are living in your hometown or if you are living on the other side of the world. Because as we've seen, physical proximity does not mean that time stands still. It does not mean that we are automatically connected. Let us ask our nostalgia, what is it pointing to? Let us figure out what we are longing for and figure out how we can build a life around the scaffolding of that longing. At least a little bit. At least a little bit creating home. My friends, we are not fated to be lonely. We can build connections wherever we are. We can create families and clans and communities, even if we can never recreate exactly the circumstances of our youth. We can break out of these culturally imposed isolations that tell us that home is only in the past. We can learn to sing one another's songs, and we can share our songs with one another. Together, through love and care, we can build a sense of home that we will not have to come back to, because it will always be with us. May it be so.
Like a plastic bag drifting through the wind, wanting to start again. Do you ever feel so paper thin, like a house of cards, one blow from caving in? Do you ever feel already buried deep, 6 feet under screens, but no one seems to hear a thing? Do you know that there's still a chance for you, 'cause there's a spark in you? You just gotta ignite the light and let it shine. Just own the night like the 4th of July. 'Cause baby, you're a firework. Come on, show them what you were. Make them go up, up, up as you shoot them. Future holds after a hurricane comes a rainbow, maybe a reason why all the doors are closed, so you could open one that leads you to the perfect road. Like a lightning bolt, your heart will grow, and in its time, you know, you just gotta ignite the light.
Even brighter than the moon.
And so we end as we began, singing together. My friends, music reminds us that time is not an insurmountable wall, but merely another measure of distance that we can, through love, bridge. We learn to sing one another's songs. We share our songs with one another. In doing so, may we create an ever-changing, ever-growing, ever-embracing sense of home. Amen. Thank you, Jim. Thank you, Tom. Thank you, everybody, for the beautiful music today. My friends, I hope to see you in Elliott Hall. I hope you will join us for coffee hour. And please feel free to share your own stories of home. Go forth.